Can you see me? Can you hear me? No, not really.
This is what my seminar would look like if I were coming to you live from Mars using a radio link aboard NASA's Curiosity rover. This isn't enough to run a Zoom meeting through, and it certainly isn't enough if we eventually want to send humans to the planet. And now this is what it would look like if I were coming to you using a laser-based free space optic link. And we wouldn't just have one video screen, we could have up to 150 of them. Free space optics has never been applied to Mars, perhaps because we've never simulated the effects of Martian atmospheric interference on the propagation of the laser beam. So for this thesis, that's what I've been investigating. I've created a tool, validated it using Earth data, and then applied it to the Martian context. Free space optics uses modulated pulses of infrared or visible light in order to transfer lots of information very quickly. The free space in free space optics denotes the atmospheric gases which our laser beam has to travel through. Like my loaf of bread, although the atmosphere might appear homogeneous, it actually contains thousands of tiny turbulent cells, or eddies. These are much like the air bubbles inside my loaf of bread. Large eddies on the scale of a few meters causes the beam to deflect, while smaller ones cause it to spread apart. Over tens of kilometers, this can make our beam really quite weak and potentially miss the receiver entirely. These disruptive effects of atmospheric turbulence are known as scintillation. The most widely accepted form of simulating this atmospheric scintillation is by using the phase screen technique. To illustrate how it works, and to keep with our bread analogy from earlier, I'll be using this baguette. We have a transmitter at one end and receiver at the other. This is our propagation pathway. Rather than simulating all of the individual eddies inside the loaf, instead we split it into a number of different 3D sections. We then take each of these slabs and compress the effects of atmospheric turbulence within them into an infinitely thin plane, known as a phase screen.
Since this is a numerical technique, the phase screen has to have a certain resolution, typically measured in pixels. This one is 32 by 32 pixels, and you can physically see them. In reality, we'd want something more like 4096 by 4096. We distribute the phase screens over the propagation pathway, locating them in the center of their respective slabs. Next, we generate a Gaussian beam at the transmitter and propagate it through. When it interacts with a phase screen, all the scintillation occurs for that section of path. Here are some of the actual screens and results generated using my code. As you can see, it starts out pretty regular and then degrades and spreads over time. A receiver collects the final beam, perhaps missing some of it if it deflected too far or spread out too much. The relative recoupled power is a statistic taken by dividing the received power over the transmitted power. Atmospheric turbulence is by its nature a very, very random process, so to obtain meaningful results, we run the simulation a few hundred times and compare the collected power. In this investigation, I've nominally selected 250 trials, since it gives enough results for a normal distribution to be formed consistently. The scintillation index is the standard deviation divided by the mean.
By understanding the scintillation index of different configurations in different locations, we can work out where the best place to put our link is. We can improve the communication by using a higher power transmitter, a receiver with a larger collecting area, moving the two closer together, or by just having an atmosphere which has a lower level of scintillation. Perhaps Mars could be an ideal candidate. To calculate the scintillation index of Mars, we need two things: atmospheric data and a model through which to run it through. Now, we do have some data for Mars, but it's not the sort of precision that we would need to do a single test and call it a day. Instead, we need to run Monte Carlo analysis, performing thousands of such experiments and finding an average which gives us an approximate value for what Mars should be. Now, there are some existing tools for calculating scintillation, but none of them are fast enough in order to make Monte Carlo analysis efficient. So for my thesis, I decided to create my own, using the fundamentals of computing to make sure it was efficient. Typically, this form of calculation is run on a computer's CPU, or central processing unit. It's a little bit like a cathode ray tube, where we have a stream of electrons going back and forth rapidly in order to produce an image. It works well for smaller screens, but as they get larger and larger, it becomes less efficient. That's where a GPU, or graphical processing unit, comes in. It's able to take one big calculation and split it up into thousands of smaller ones, each of them running on their own independent thread. It's a bit like upgrading to an LCD display, where we can have thousands of individual pixels turning on and off in order to create an image.
In 2004, Sedmak took 17 seconds in order to create his 1024 by 1024 screens using the CPU. Just a couple of years later, Paulson did it in just 1.5 seconds by using the GPU of his machine.
We can keep scaling GPUs up bigger and bigger with almost no extra time penalty. Until, of course, we run out of space on the GPU and the whole computer crumbles. Another development in high-speed computing is the use of parallel computation, allowing us to operate more than one core at a time. It's a little bit like playing Terminator with two players rather than just one. Prior to my thesis, practically all phase screen programs were written using MATLAB. It's a high-level programming language, which takes care of many of the matrix operations required for this sort of calculation. These include SynSim, which was created by my supervisor.
What MATLAB makes up for in ease of use, it loses in efficiency of execution and doesn't have all the functions you might need. For example, although it does support GPU operation, it doesn't support parallel execution. I decided to make my program in the C programming language, since it gives much lower level control of critical CPU operations. The CUDA plugin, developed by NVIDIA, the same company which creates the world's highest powered graphics cards, was used to give a similar level of control over the GPU. Rather than developing all of the scintillation code myself from scratch, I instead translated some SynSim code from MATLAB into this C language. I called my program Casper, or CUDA accelerated SynSim with parallel execution routine. A detailed line-by-line comparison of SynSim and Casper to explain how the program works is unwarranted, but by comparing how the two complete the same basic function, we can get an insight onto how they differ. To create a phase screen, we begin with an array of complex random numbers, and then feed these through a spectral density function. Such functions have been determined experimentally over years of atmospheric testing, typically giving more scintillation at lower altitudes, and then less as we get higher. The one used in Casper is the Kolmogorov function, named for its inventor and Soviet mathematician Andrei Kolmogorov. A fundamental part of this operation is to complete a fast Fourier transform, which converts our signal into the frequency domain. This also requires a shift operation to move the zero frequency components into the center of the array. To complete the shift, we begin by calling a global GPU function, which I've appropriately called FFTShift. The FFTShift operation switches the second and fourth quartiles, and then the first and the third. The triple brackets used are to initialize a certain number of threads within the GPU, and are identified in grids and blocks. To illustrate what's going on here, I'm using a tiny 4x4 matrix. 16 elements means we need 16 threads. I've stored all of the phase screens as a single block of data, which is fed in using this pointer. This variable gives the precise screen we're considering within that block. We also include the size of the phase screen. The block size variable helps with indexing. With the GPU now called, we have 16 threads, each of which knows the data that we want analyzed and the other variables that we fed in. Remembering that computers start counting at zero, an instance that is the second thread in block 1 has an index of 6. Our other threads are numbered 0 through to 15. This next line checks that our instance corresponds to an element in the upper half of the matrix. If it is, we proceed. If not, then the thread terminates. A second statement checks if our index is in the first or the second quartile. In this case, it's in the first. We then have a shift value, which tells us how many steps away we need to move our original in order for it to switch correctly. In this case, it will be 6 along. We save the value of index 12 to a temporary storage. It's a complex number, so it requires the cuffed double complex data storage format. Next, we replace the value of index 12 with the value of index 6, and then replace 6 with the stored value from earlier, effectively switching the two. Its task complete, the thread disappears. While this has been taking place, 15 other threads have been discovering their identity and switching their respective matrix elements, so that by the time index 6 and index 12 are switched, the others are either completed or well on their way to being finished. This synchronized function makes the calculation wait until all threads have been completed. If they hadn't, then we might get strange errors later on, with some of the matrices lagging behind the rest. We loop this function across all the phase screens. Next, we call the final fast Fourier transform. This routine is frequently used in signal processing, and was traditionally a very slow operation. However, back in 1997, Frigo and Johnson from MIT wrote an extremely fast way of calculating the transform and published it as a C-ready library called FFTW, or the fastest Fourier transform in the West. MIT is of course in the Eastern United States, but the pair hail from Italy, so thought it appropriate. Not even Frigo and Johnson completely understand why their code is so fast, but NVIDIA created their own equivalent function for CUDA and the GPU, so I've been more than happy to use it in my project. When Casper is first loaded, it generates a plan through which to execute any fast Fourier transform, as long as it is of a defined size. It takes a few hundredths of a second to generate this first time, but once it's done, we can call the CUDA fast Fourier transform at any time we want, and the entire operation takes place in only a couple of milliseconds. These variables are telling the function where the plan is stored, where the data comes from, where to put it, and that we're doing a forwards transform into the frequency domain. Notice that although we still have a synchronized function, there is no loop, and that's because this function that we're calling does all of that internally. And now we have our modified frequency matrix, ready to be modulated by the atmospheric properties we desire.
With SynSyn, that entire operation takes place with this single line of code. You can see why most people choose to use MATLAB.
In its current version, Casper runs from the system terminal. The user selects a GPU number and starting seed. More terminals can be started simultaneously and made to run on separate GPUs, or even the same GPU if there is enough space. After a short startup period, which assigns space in the GPU and sets up the random variables, we begin the simulation. Relative recoupled power is saved to a text file and then plotted in groups of 250, giving us the scintillation index for each trial. But how do we know if these results are correct?
Our first question to answer is, are the two programs identical? Do they produce the same result? This was easy to test for some functions. For example, the propagation from one phase screen to another could just be compared by subtracting one result from the other. If it gave zero, then we know it was correct. On the other hand, many functions are less deterministic, relying on lots of different random variables. For example, here are two phase screens, one created by Casper and the other SynSyn. If we subtract one from the other, then we get a really confusing and, to be honest with you, meaningless result. If, however, we qualitatively compare a number of different phase screens, we can see that they are indeed very similar. They have the same sort of ranges and produce the similar sort of pattern. With each of the individual functions working correctly, it was time to bring them together into one cohesive program. I then tested it by running 500,000 simulations.
This involved running 100 blocks of 250 simulations each for each of the two programs. In this graph, we have the results of all 5,000 simulations, comparing the relative recoupled power with how often that value was received. As you can see, they have almost identical results, with very similar means and standard deviations. I then compared the difference in scintillation index between each block of 250 SynSyn and Casper simulations, comparing block 1 SynSyn with block 1 Casper and so on. An equivalence test showed that the two populations were identical to within the 0.05 significance limit.
So the outputs are identical, but how does the speed compare? I tested this using a base case of 12 phase screens of 4096 by 4096 pixels and ran this 250 times, just to get a rough average. SynSyn, which as we can recall is the best available on the market, can do this calculation in about 40 minutes. Casper, with all of its extra improvements, does it in only 10. That's a 4x improvement with the exact same inputs, exact same phase screens, and exact same hardware. A huge improvement.
An interesting observation I made was that the calculations for Casper started out quickly, but then slowed down after a few runs. I first thought that this was a software problem to do with some sort of memory leak. One of the downsides of programming in C is that if you don't explicitly tell the program that it doesn't need a piece of memory, then it ends up sticking around. However, I manually checked the program and no such leak issues were detected. Perhaps then it was a hardware issue. I decided to run a third command window alongside my two Casper simulations, and with this I queried the GPU unit directly to get some diagnostics. At the beginning, the computer was operating at a cool 30 degrees, but after just a few seconds of Casper calculations, it had heated up to almost 70. As a safety measure to stop our processor from spontaneously combusting, modern computers artificially reduce their processing speed to reduce excess heat generation. After a time, an equilibrium was evidently reached, and speed stays constant. It was really interesting to see the interplay of software and hardware in action.
With a very fast and reliable Casper core, it was time to apply it to the Martian atmosphere. Our first step was in selecting a beam. It had to have a wavelength which has high transmittance for the Martian atmosphere. On Earth, 1550 nanometers is pretty common, and as you can see, falls right in the middle of the high part of transmittance. One of the most striking differences between the Terran and Martian atmospheres is their differing composition.
Earth's is dominated by nitrogen and oxygen, while on Mars, carbon dioxide plays the leading role. Unfortunately, there have been no transmission tests for the 1550 nanometer wavelength on Mars. However, since we know the atmospheric composition and are able to form a few experimental tests with pure samples of each of the gases, we can actually derive our own profile. With the assistance of a model created by NASA scientist Geronimo Vanelli, here is the atmospheric transmission spectrum which I generated for Mars. As you can see, our 1550 nanometer band lies just within the high transmission region. This is really useful because it means that when we go to Mars, we don't need to create a whole new transmitter and receiver layout. We can just use the ones we developed here on Earth. That is, if scintillation isn't too extreme. The refractive index structure parameter, Cn squared, is an essential input for our model, giving the relative strength of scintillation throughout our region of atmosphere. On Earth, this can be determined experimentally, using tools such as weather balloon-mounted laser beams. Through dimensional analysis in 1987, an ass determined that Cn squared was dependent only on pressure, temperature, and the mean squared temperature fluctuation. Since we've had rovers on the planet since 1997, long-term ground-based measurements of temperature fluctuations are easy to obtain. This gives a Cn squared of about 1.2% of that of the Earth's, at least at ground level. Going higher, data is more limited. The only time when in-situ measurements can actually be made is during the final descent phase of Martian landers, a time when there are typically more pressing concerns, such as when to deploy the parachutes. By comparing a range of descent profiles, I was able to obtain an approximate temperature function for along the path. Obviously, this form of inference contains quite a lot of error, so I've incorporated it into the Monte Carlo tests with quite a large standard deviation, equal to half the range between the lowest and highest values. I used a similar approach for other atmospheric characteristics, such as the length scale of turbulent eddies and the thickness of different layers of atmosphere. Unfortunately, the computer which I normally run my models on is currently undergoing repairs, so I haven't been able to conduct any of the Monte Carlo analysis with the full phase screen size and number of trials which I would have hoped for. However, some preliminary results conducted on my laptop are quite encouraging. For example, we have 20 times more collected power with the Martian receiver than we would have on the Earth. We can get away with using a smaller, less powerful transmitter on the rover, saving energy and space for more experiments. Going forward, there are several exciting avenues for investigation, relating both to the Martian context as well as CASPER itself. CASPER is already the fastest program of its type in the world, but I think we can still push it a little bit further. If we do a timing function of all the different calculations being involved, we see that assigning phase screens takes the most time. This should be a focus of early improvements. Another area for improvement is ensuring that the CPU and GPU are being used to their full extent all the time. As you can see with this function, which has tracked their respective usage, the CPU is often waiting for the GPU, and the GPU in turn waiting for the CPU. This is pretty inefficient. One of my peers is currently conducting research into the optimal placement of different phase screens. If we were to take this on board, we could reduce the amount of calculations required while still giving a very accurate result. This would make a much faster and yet more accurate program. There is still much more to uncover within the Martian context. For example, one of the assumptions made when creating the atmospheric model for Mars was that dust would play a negligible effect. This was in order to match assumptions made for Earth-based models. However, if we were to incorporate the impact of dust, we would expect to see a much lower power being received at the satellite end. This wouldn't really affect the results for the scintillation index, but is an important next step when uncovering the suitability of Mars for free space optics. To complement the numerical modelling, which has made the foundation of this thesis, some actual experiments would be required. We could do this by adapting some existing equipment on Mars.
Ultimately, though, we will need to go to the planet with specialist scintillation measuring equipment in order to obtain a true Martian atmospheric profile.
In this presentation, I've introduced the importance of free space optics and described the fabrication of a tool in order to simulate atmospheric scintillation within a Martian context. CASPER doesn't just do the job and do it accurately, it also is 4 times faster than the next best alternative, leaving these other tools in the dust. I've shared some of our preliminary results from within the Martian context, which suggest that this technology is ideally suited for this Martian conditions. When the first astronauts step foot on the red planet, perhaps their video will be streamed in ultra-high definition via a free space link. This has been James Dingley from the Atomic Frontier. Keep looking up.